I am Dr. K. Chandrasekhar Reddy. Obtained BTEC and PhD from Sri Venkateswara University, Tirupati, Andhra Pradesh, and MTech from National Institute of Engineering, Mysore. My specialization is Water Resource Engineering. I have more than 24 years of teaching and industry experience. I taught both undergraduate and postgraduate students. I have published numerous technical papers in various reputed national and international journals. The subject of design and drawing of irrigation structures. Under that, sloping glacis weir. First of all, what is a weir? What is a sloping glacis weir? First of all, we will see what is a weir. A weir which is constructed across a perennial river to raise water level and to divert the water to canal in the system of diversion network. If you see, this is the diversion network. In this diversion network, here we constructed the weir and to raise the water and divert the water into the networking of canals. Out of the weirs, there are n number of weirs. One type of the weir is sloping glacis weir. This is the sloping glacis weir. Sloping glacis weir is one type of the weir used for this purpose. Advantage over other weirs is hydraulic jump formation to dissipate the energy of overflowing water. If you observe here, once the water is flowing here, here the hydraulic jump will be forming. Using the advantage of formation of this hydraulic jump, we can dissipate the energy. That is the advantage of sloping glacis weir when compared to other weirs. Weir of this type is of recent origin. This type is suitable for soft sandy foundations. It is used where weir crest and downstream river bed is not more than 3 meters. This is the data required to design the sloping glacis weir. The values given in the bracket with bold, this is for your homework. For this values, we will design now and later you can design for this values. Design a sloping glacis weir for the following site condition. Maximum discharge intensity on weir crest 10 cumex per meter. High flood level before construction of weir 255.00. RL of riverbed 249.50. Pond level 254.00. Height of crest shutter 1 meter. Anticipated downstream water level in the river when the weir is discharging with pond level upstream 251 meters. Bed retrogression 0.5 meters. Lacis silt factor 0.9. Permissible exit gradient 1 in 7. Permissible afflux 1 meter. The various components under this sloping glacis weir. This is the outline of the sloping glacis weir. The first component is crest level of the weir. What this is the crest and what is the level of this crest. Elevation of upstream side total energy line. This is the elevation of upstream side total energy line. Velocity head. How much is the velocity head between high flood level and total energy line. Loss of head at high flood level. Under the condition of high flood level, what is the loss of head? Loss of head at pond level. When water is at the pond level, what is the loss of head? Hydraulic jump calculations. Hydraulic jump calculations means level at which jump will form, upstream specific energy, pre and post jump depth, height of the jump and length of the floor, both high flood and pond level conditions. These are all including hydraulic jump calculations. Design of glacis. Upstream side glacis, downstream side glacis. Depth of sheet fill. This is the upstream side sheet fill, downstream side sheet fill, intermediate sheet fill. Length of the impervious floor. How much will be the length of the impervious floor? Pressure at key points. These are the key points. These are the key points. Elevation of subsoil hydraulic glide lines for various conditions that are maximum static head condition, flow at high flood condition and pond level conditions. This is the subsoil hydraulic line for no flow condition. Plotting the pre-jump water surface profile for the two flow conditions. The two flow conditions are high flood and pond level condition. Calculations for floor thickness. How much is this thickness and this thickness, how much? Upstream protection works. These are all come under the upstream side protection work. Downstream side protection work. This is the drumstring side production work. These are the components to be designed. Now we will start the first step. First we will design crest level of the wear. Where shall we put this level of this crest? Pond level, it is given 254.0 meters. This is the pond level. Height of shutters also given. This is the 1 meter. Pond level minus height of shutters equal to 253. Therefore, this 253 is the crest level. First step is over. Second step, elevation of upstream side total energy line. Before going to that, we will recall discharge formula for broadcasted rectangular wave. General rectangular wave equation, Q equal to 2/3 CDL, 2 to G, H to the power of 3/2. For the case of broadcasted wave, coefficient of discharge equal to 0.577. If you substitute in this equation and take L in this side, Q by L, that equal to small q, that equal to 1.7 H to the power of 3/2. It is given in the data, Q equal to 10, substitute here, find out what is the H value. H value we obtained 3.25 meter. Therefore, elevation of upstream side total energy line, that is equal to RL of the crest plus H, 253 plus 256.25. Therefore, elevation of upstream side total energy line equal to 256.25. Next, third step, calculation of velocity head. Before going to the velocity head, find out what is the regime's cover depth using lazy silk theory. Already it is given, lazy silk factor equal to 0.9, Q also given 10. Substitute in this equation, 1.35, Q square by F whole to the power of 1 by 3. If you substitute all these values in this equation, we can get approximately 6.5 meters. Regime velocity V equal to Q by R. Q 10, it is given. From this 6.5 we obtained, we substitute in this equation, we can get regime velocity 1.54 meters per second. Therefore, velocity head V square by 2G. Substitute in this, we can get 0.12 meter. So, velocity head equal to 0.12 meter. Next step, step 4, loss of head at high flood. Upstream side high flood level equal to upstream side total energy line minus velocity head. Substitute in this all the values, we can get 256.13 meter. Level of downstream side total energy line, that is equal to high flood level before construction plus V square by 2G, that equal to 255.0 plus 0.12, we can get 255.12 meter. Therefore, upflex equal to upstream side high flood level minus downstream side high flood level, that equal to, if we substitute all these values, we can get 1.13 meter. This is very near to the permissible upflex of 1 meter. The downstream side high flood level after retrogression, that equal to high flood level before construction minus bed retrogression, that equal to 255.0 minus 0.5 254.5 meter. What is this retrogression? Retrogression, it is lowering downstream side bed caused by water scour. Because of the scour, downstream side bed may be lowered. That we call it as a retrogression. Usually, we will take 0.5 meters as the bed retrogression. Downstream side total energy line after retrogression equal to level of downstream side total energy line minus bed retrogression. Substitute this value, we can get 254.62 meter. Therefore, loss of head at high flood level equal to upstream side total energy line minus downstream side total energy line after retrogression. Substituting these two values, we can get 1.63 meter. So, 1.63 meters is the loss of head at high flood level condition. Now, we will see what is the loss of head at pond level condition. This is at high flood level condition. Now, we will see at pond level condition. When the weir is discharging with pond level upstream, head over the crest equal to 254 minus 253, that equal to 1 meter. Therefore, discharge Q equal to, already we calculated, we know that this equation Q equal to 1.7 K to the power of 3/2. Substitute these values in this equation, we can get 1.7 cubic per meter. Loss of head at pond level will be given by pond level minus anticipated downstream side water level at that time, that equal to 254 minus 251.5. that equal to 2.5 meter. So this is the loss of head at pond level condition. This is the loss of head at high flood condition. Next we will see step 6. Already we discussed hydraulism calculations. Hydraulism calculations includes will be formed on the downstream. Hydraulism will be formed on the downstream side sloping glaciers. The hydraulism calculations are done in the tabular form and as shown in the table given below. Serial number, description, high flood condition, pond level condition, these two conditions. First one, discharge intensity. Q equal to 10 cubic in the case of high flood condition, 1.7 cubic in the case of pond level condition. Head loss 1.63 meters, 2.5 meters. Downstream specific energy, this we can obtain using this data from the Blinn's curves. We obtained 4.3, 1.7. Level at which jump will form, that is equal to downstream side total energy line after retrogression minus EF2. We substitute these values in this equation, we get 250.32 meters, 249.8 meters. Similarly, upstream specific energy EF1, that equal to EF2 plus loss of head, 5.93, 4.2. Pre jump depth that we indicated as a D1 corresponding to EF1, it can be obtained from specific energy curve, that is Montague's curves, or you can calculate using this equation. In this case, we calculated using this equation. Substituting all these values in this equation, we can get 1.03 meters, 0.15 meters. Post jump depth, that is D2, corresponding to EF2. From specific, ED2 also can be calculated from the specific energy curves, or we may calculate it using this equation. In this case, we calculated using this equation D2 plus Q by D2 whole square by 2G. From that, we can obtain 3.96 meters, 1.68 meters. Next, height of the jump. Height of the jump equal to the difference between the pre-jump and post-jump, D2 minus D1. If we substitute these values, we can get 2.96 meters and 1.53 meters. Similarly, we can calculate length of the concrete floor required beyond the jump. After the jump, how much of the length of the floor we require? That is 5 times of the D2 minus D1, post jump depth minus pre jump depth. You substitute in this, you can get 14.65 meters. Let us assume 15 meters of length and 7.56 meters for the condition of pond level, and for the condition of high flood, 15 meters. Step 7. Design of glaciers. Let the crest width equal to 2 meters. This is the crest width, 2 meters. Upstream slope of the glaciers 2:1. This is the upstream glaciers. The slope is 2:1. And downstream glaciers slope 3:1. This is the downstream glaciers and its slope is 3:1. Adopt downstream floor RL 249.8 minus 0.2 249.6 meters, that is 0.2 meters below the lowest level at which jump will form. Horizontal length of the floor beyond the toe of the glaciers. From here to, this is the toe of the glaciers, from here to here, that is the length of the horizontal floor, that equal to 15 meters. Next, step 8, depth of sheet wells. From here to here, how much will be the depth? This is upstream side file, downstream downstream side file, intermediate file. What is this depth? R equal to 6.5 meters. Therefore, RL of bottom of cover hole at upstream end equal to upstream side high flood level minus 1.5 times of the R, that equal to 256.13 minus 1.576.5, that equal to 246.38. meters. So this level equal to 246.38. Therefore, keep RL of bottom of stream side file at 246.38 meters. RL of bottom of score hole at downstream side end, that equal to downstream side high flood level minus 2 times R. In the upstream side, we are considering only 1.5 times of the score depth. In the downstream side case, 2 times of the score depth. Substitute in this value, we can get 241.5 meters. Keep RL of the bottom downstream side file at 241.5 meters. This is the transmission required, and this bottom equal to 241.5. Provide the intermediate file. This is the intermediate file at the downstream store of the glacis. This is the upstream side and downstream side of the glacis. As the second line of defense, with its bottom level at the same as that of the 241.5, here also 241 as that of the downstream side plate. Next, step 9, length of the impervious floor. Maximum percolation head equal to pond level minus downstream side floor level, that 254 minus 249.6 4.4 meter. Depth of downstream side cutoff equal to downstream side floor level minus RL of bottom downstream side pile. If we substitute those two, we can get 8.1 meter. According to Kosla's theory, permissible gradient given in the design is 1.7. This G equal to HS by D into 1 by pi root lambda. Therefore, 1 by pi root lambda equal to G D by HS is 1 by 7 into 8.1 by 414, that equal to 0.263. Hence, from Clausius exit gradient curve, if we see for 1 by pi root lambda for 2.263, we can get alpha value equal to 1.4. This is obtained from Clausius exit gradient curve. That is equal to B by T. What is the B? Length of the impervious floor. That equal to, if you take here, B equal to 1.5 times of D. 1.5 of D equal to 1.5 into 8.1, that equal to 12.2 meters. Floor length already provided from other considerations. What are the other considerations? Horizontal length of the upstream glacis, length of the crest, horizontal length of the downstream side glacis, plus length of the floor beyond the toe of the glacis. If we substitute all these values here, we can get 34.2 meters. Thus, the floor length already provided is much more than that required from the permissible exit gradient conditions. We already provided for different considerations. These are our consideration. The length of floor equals 34.2. But as per the condition, we require 12.2. So, 34.2 is more than sufficient than that of this permissible 12.2. And no upstream floor is required. However, provide a minimum of 1.8 meters length of upstream side floor, so that the total length of the impervious floor becomes 36 meters. So 34.2 plus 1.2, 36 meters. 36 meters is the total floor length from here to here, that is 36 meters. Pressure at key points. We already discussed this is the key points. In these key points, we will find out what are the pressures. Having known the profile of the glacis and the floor from the figure, let us now calculate the pressure at key points by assuming the preliminary thickness of the floor at various points as given below. For that, first of all, we should assume some thickness and we will decide whether the thickness is sufficient or not. Floor thickness at upstream side of the crest, 1 meter. 1 meter here. Floor thickness at downstream side end of the glacis at intermediate pile, 2 meters. Here it is 2 meters thickness. Floor thickness at downstream end of the floor, 1.5 meters here. The thickness is 1.5 meters. The calculations of pressure at various key points have been done in table given below with reference to this figure. These are the assumed values. We will see whether these values are sufficient or not. Calculations for subsoil uplift pressure length of the floor with 36 meters. File line at the pressure point, depth of file in meters, 1 by alpha D by B, B1 value, B1 by B value equal to B by AD, percentage pressure before correction, correction for thickness, correction for slope, correction for interference, after correction, all this related to Kosla's theory. Upstream side pile at point C1, at point D1, if you observe here 3.12, 0.87, from this before construction correction 72, 81, 3.1, 3.7, 78.8, 82. Similarly, intermediate pile at point C2, at point D2, at point E2. These values you can obtain. Similarly, at a downstream side file, point D1, point E2. These are the values are calculated as per this equation using Kozlov's charts. Next, step 11, elevation of subsoil hydrated gradient lines for various conditions. Already we discussed three conditions: maximum static head condition, high flood condition, and flow at pond level condition. After having known the percentage pressure at various key points, previous step we calculated all these pressure points. The elevation of the subsoil hydrated gradient line for these conditions can be determined as illustrated in table given below. Elevation of subsoil hydrated gradient lines for various flow conditions. What is the condition, datum, that is the downstream side flow level or downstream water level in terms of meter, upstream side water level, height or elevation of subsoil hydrated gradient line above the datum in meters, upstream side file, intermediate file, and downstream side file for height and elevation. Now, for no flow condition, 254 minus, that is 4.4 meters, datum equal to 249.6, upstream side water level is 254.00, all these values for different percentages. Similarly, high flood condition, this is the high flood condition, these are the values obtained. For flow at pond level condition, for the pond level condition, this is the values we obtain. Step 12, plotting of the pre-jump water surface profile for the two flow conditions. The two flow conditions are pond level condition and high flood level condition. The uplift pressure at any point will be equal to the difference in elevation between the subsoil hydrated gradient line and the elevation of water surface corresponding to the jump profiles for the two flow conditions, or the downstream side flow for no flow conditions. Hence, it is essential to plot the water surface profile of the jump. Plotting of the water surface on the downstream side glacis before the formation of the jump can be obtained by finding depth D1 at various points with the help of Montague curves. The calculations are shown in the given table. Pre-jump profiles before jump. RL of crest equal to 253.0 meter. Distance from downstream side end of the crest. RL of glacis. High flood condition. Pond level condition. Under that, distance from 3 meters, 6 meters, 8.0 meters. Jump location for high flood. 9.6 jump location for pond level. RL of glacis, these are the values, the corresponding EF1, pre-jump depth, EF1, pre-jump depth. These are the values obtained. Step 3, calculations for floor thicknesses. Figure A, this is the figure A, shows the subsoil hydrated line for the two conditions. This is a subsoil hydrated gradient line for pond level condition. This is for high flood level condition. Subsoil hydrated gradient line for high flood condition. Subsoil hydrated gradient line for pond level. These are the two conditions. The floor is to be designed for the maximum unbalanced head found by substrating elevation of water surface profile or downstream side bed level as the case may be, from the elevation of the corresponding hydrated gradient line. First, at the point of formation of hydrated jump for high flood condition, unbalanced head for high flood condition from this figure, it is equal to 4 meters. Unbalanced static head for no flow condition is 2.56 meters. Therefore, design head equal to 4 meters. For highest value is 4 meters. Therefore, design head equal to 4 meters. Since the design head is greater for high flood condition, the floor is designed for 2/3 of this head. 2/3 of this head equal to 2/3 of 4 equal to 2.67 meter. Therefore, the thickness equal to 2.67 divided by rho minus 1. Rho is the specific weight of the specific gravity of the material. Here we assume specific gravity of the material is 2.24. So, head divided by rho minus 1. 2.24 minus 1, that equal to 2.15 meters. At the point of formation of hydraulic jump for flow at pond level condition, under that, unbalanced head for pond level condition 2.9 meters. 2/3 of similarly, 2/3 of this head equal to 2/3 of 2.9, 1.93 meters. Unbalanced static head for no flow condition 2.2 meters. So for this no flow condition 2.2. Therefore, design, it is more than 1.93. So you consider this 2.2 meters. Therefore, design head equal to 2.25 meters. Thickness equal to this head by rho minus 1. That is 1.8 meters. This is less than the thickness of 2.1 meters found for high flood condition determined above. Hence, provide the thickness of 2.15 meters at the downstream side end of the glacis, decreasing it at 1.5 meters at the end of the crest. A nominal thickness of 1 meter is to be provided for the floor of the upstream side glacis as shown in figure. This we consider 1 meter. Here we can provide 2.15 meter and we reduce it to 1.5 meters. Third one, floor thickness at downstream side of sloping glacis. This already we calculated upstream side thickness and this, and now we will design the thickness of this floor. It will be seen from figure A and B. This is the figure A and B. That the design head for the floor to the upstream side, downstream side of the sloping glacis will be governed by the unbalanced static head, which is greater than 2/3 of the unbalanced head under the two flow conditions. Pressure head at point E3. This is the point E3. At a downstream side, the floor equal to 1.5 meter. Therefore, the thickness required equal to head by rho minus 1. 2.24 minus 1, 1.24. So, 1.5 by 1.24. That equal to 1.1 meters. We may take 1.25 meters. Thus, the downstream side floor has a thickness of 2.15 meters at the downstream end of the glacis. Here, this is 2.15 meters. And a thickness of 1.25 meters at the downstream side floor. This reduction, then linearly, this will be reduced linearly as shown in this. Next, step 14, upstream protection works. These are all the, from here to here, we call it as a upstream side protection works. Under this, launching upfront, block protection and filter. Upstream protection works. Depth of upstream side cover walls below bed level, that equal to D1 equal to 249.5 minus 246.38, 3.12 meters. Minimum length of upstream side block protection equal to D1, 3.12 meters. However, provide 1 meter thick stone blocks laid over 0.5 meters thick graded stones for a length of 3.5 meters. If we see here, this block protection will be laid over the graded stones for a length of, from here to here, 3.5 meters, this portion. Minimum length of upstream side launching upfront. This is the launching upfront. The minimum length is 1.5 times of the D1, that equal to 4.7 meters, with a thickness of 1 meter thickness on a launched slope of 2:1. However, provide 1 meter thick launching upfront for a length of 5 meters at the ground. Instead of 4.7 meters, we are rounded up its value to the 5 meters. Now we provide a launching upfront of 5 meters. From here to here, we call it as a launching upfront. Its thickness is 1.5 meters. Step 15. Downstream side protection walls. After the impervious floor, this entire portion, we call it as a downstream side protection wall. Here also launching upfront, graded filter over that thickness of stones. On, 1 meter thick stones on 0.5 meters graded inverted filter. Downstream protection walls. Depth of downstream side cover walls below the bed level. D2 equal to 249.6 minus 241.5. 8.1 meters. Therefore, length of the inverted filter equal to 1.5 times at D2. It is approximately 12 meters. From here, this portion to this portion, the length equal to 12 meters. Provide 12 meters length of the inverted filter consisting of 1 meter thick stones laid. This is the 1 meter thick stone is laid on 0.5 meter thick graded inverted filter. This is the 0.5 meter thick graded filter. This is 1 and 0.5, totally 1.5 meter thickness with a length of 12 meters. Length of downstream side launching apron. This is the downstream side launching apron. Here it shows a cut portion. Don't think that it is a two portions. Instead of drawing a single line, not possible to draw 12 meter. That is why we shown it as a cut portion. That means it is continued. It is not possible to draw onto the scale 12 meters on this paper. That is why we shown it as a two parts and shown this cut portion. Length of the downstream side launching apron equal to 1.5 times of T2. That equal to 12 meters. From here to here, this is also 12 meters. The minimum thickness on launched slope should be 1 meter. However, 1 meter, but we are providing 1.5. This is 1.5 meter. So, here also we are providing 1.5 meter. Hence, provide 12 meters length of launching apron of 1.5 meter thick. These are the sections to be drawn on the drawing sheet. Longitudinal section of the weir, this is the longitudinal section of the weir, and this is hydraulic lines and water surface profiles. These two should be drawn on the drawing sheet. First, we start with this, start the drawing of width of the crest, then sloping glacis, and this length 1.8 meters, we assume totally 36 meters, and this sheet file depth, and this sheet file, and first you draw this portion. After drawing that, with this gradient, you draw this line. That is a subsoil header line for pond level condition. We know all these points, you substitute and you draw this. Then you draw this subsoil header line for high flood condition. This is for subsoil header line for high flood. You draw these two lines. Next, you draw the two hydrologisms. One is for pond level condition and high flood level condition. We know the pre-jump and post-jump. This is the pre-jump depth and post-jump depth for both the cases with that profile, hydrologism profile. Already we calculated that. Using that, you draw this. This is the hydrologism for high flood condition. This is the hydrologism for pond level condition. You draw these two lines and mark neatly all these values. And you draw here hydrologic lines for water surface profile. Then you start drawing of this portion. Already I told, here we are showing this portion, cut portion, because we cannot draw total length on a drawing sheet. That is why you shown this cut portion here. That means it is continued. This is also continued. We are unable to draw total length of 12 meters in the drawing sheet. That is why we are showing this symbol. First you draw this width of the crest and you draw this sloping glacis, and we know the thickness. Here 1 meter and 1.5 meter, 2.15, 1.25. Gradually, you draw this lines, join this lines. Then, you draw the this block protection and launching up on this upstream side protection works. Then, you come to the downstream side protection works and you draw both the graded rainwater filter and launching up on. Then you draw this, we know this level and we know this level, 241.5 up to 2.1 you draw this. We know this level, here also you can draw this line, thick line with 2.41 meters. We know the upstream side also, 246.38, you draw the upstream side pipe. Then you draw this subsoil hydro line for no flow condition, we know all this are needed. You substitute and you draw, we know the height of the shutters, you draw the height of shutters and show the pond level. It is given 254. Then you draw, you write all this neatly and you mention the distance from here to here, here to here, how much is distance, and you mention it is the longitudinal section of the weir. For reference, you may verify what source engineering principles and practice by Satyanarayana Chella, published by the New Age International Publisher. For this desktop applications of all this irrigation structure is available with Radhika. You may contact through her mail to get the software developed to design drawing and estimation of these structures. Once again, I briefly explained about the design and drawing of irrigation structures. The first component, sloping glacis weir. First of all, we will see what is a weir. Weir is a constructed across a perennial river to raise water level and to divert the water to canal in the diversion of headwork. This is the diversion of headwork and this is the weir. The way out of various types of the weirs, one type of the weir is sloping glacis weir. The advantage of this sloping glacis weir over the other weirs is the formation of the hydraulic jump here. Because of this hydraulic jump, energy is to be dissipated. This is the advantage of sloping glacis weir. This is the data as usual. The bracket values will for homework. This is for we will discuss now. These are the data. Design a sloping glacis weir for the following set conditions. Maximum discharge, high flood level before construction, RL of riverbed, pond level, height of crest shutter, anticipated downstream water level with pond level upstream, bed retrogression, glacis silt factor, permeable gradient, permeable afflux. These are the components to be designed. Crest level of the weir. This is the crest level of the weir. Elevation of upstream side total energy line. Velocity head. Loss of head at high flood condition and at pond level condition. Hydraulic jump calculations. Hydraulic jump. This is the hydraulic jump. Hydraulic jump calculation means level at which the jump will form, upstream specific energy, pre depth and post depth, and for both high flood and pond level condition, design of glacis. This is the downstream side glacis, upstream side glacis. Length of the impervious floor. This is the length of the impervious floor in the downstream side and this is in the upstream side. Pressure at key points. These are the key points. Elevation of subsoil hydraulic gradient line. This is the elevation of subsoil. Plotting of free jump water surface profile for true flow conditions. Upstream protection works. These are the upstream protection. These are the downstream side protection work. As usual, design of first step. It is given the pond level is 254 and height of the shutters is given 1 meter. 254 minus 1, we get 253. So, this is the crest level of the air. First step is over. Second step, finding the upstream side total energy line. Before that, this is the equation for broadcasted rectangular weir. For broadcasted weir, coefficient discharge equal to 0.577. So, this is the discharge equation. From that, if we substitute Q already given, we substitute in this, we can get 3.25. Elevation of upstream total energy line, RL of crest plus H. This is. Next, velocity head. As per the regime scour depth equations, regime scour depth equal to 1.35 Q square wave, we substitute in this, you can get 6.5. So, from this, you can find out velocity head. Next, loss of head at high flood. Two conditions we discussed now. One is loss of head at high flood, loss of head at pond level. Or as usual, upstream side flood level equal to upstream side total energy line minus this could be to substitute this and we can get all these values. And the one more new terminology, retrogression. Retrogression means it is lowering downstream side bed caused by water scour. Because of water scour, downstream side bed may be reduced. Usually that we assume it as a 0.5 meter and we substitute it. From that we can find out the loss of bed at high flood 1.63. In the similar way, you find out loss of bed at pond level. So, the loss of bed at pond level condition is 2.5. Loss of bed at high flood condition is 1.63. Hydraulic jump calculations. This is the way you calculate for high flood condition. What are the hydraulic jump values? Discharge intensity, head loss, downstream specific energy EF1 from Blench curve, level at which jump will form, upstream specific energy, free jump depth 1, either using this equation or Montague curve. In this, you use this equation, similarly using this equation and find out the height of jump, the difference between the two depths of the jump and length of the jump beyond the. Next, design of glacis, design of downstream side glacis, design of upstream side glacis. Next, depth of sheet wells, how much of the depth of the sheet wells to be provided. Upstream side sheet fill, downstream side sheet fill, intermediate sheet fill. Length of the impervious floor. After this sloping glacis, after this concrete floor, the impervious floor, how much will be the length. using this equation, using Coase law theory, and find out 36. Next, you find out the pressure at key points. These are the various key points. Find out the pressure at these points. And calculation of for subsoil, approved pressure, upstream file, intermediate file, downstream file, at various key points, you find out this value. Next, you draw that to draw the elevation of subsoil heading land, you find out these values. One is for maximum static head, high flood condition, and flow at pond level condition. Similarly, plotting the pre jump water surface profile for the two flow condition, distance from downstream summit end of the crest 3.6, jump location for high flood 9.6, jump location for pond level, find out all these values. Calculation for floor thicknesses. This is the first case. At the point formation of hydrogen for high flood condition, what are the thickness? Similarly, at the point of formation of hydrogen for flow at pond level condition, floor thickness are downstream side of sloping glaciers for different conditions. Next, upstream side protection work. This is the upstream side protection work. Depth of upstream scour walls below the bed level D1 equal to 3.12. Minimum length of upstream side block protection is equal to D, that is 3.1. However, you provide a 3.5 meter and 1.5 times of D1, that is 5 meter. This is the launching apron. This is the block protection. Similarly, downstream side protection. This is the 1 meter thick stones on the 0.5 meter graded inverted filter. This is the launching apron. And they draw this section, L section of the weir and hydro gradient and water surface of the profile. Remember, while drawing on a drawing sheet, first to draw the left side with the 25 mm margin line, rest of the three lines, three sides with the 10 mm margin. Here we write down scale. Usually for almost all the drawings, scale may be 1:100, and to draw right here, all dimensions are in meter. Then you draw this. First you start the drawing of this portion, and you complete it, and you will go there, and you draw this, all these things as per the slope, and you complete it. This also you draw the hydro gradient line by taking, this is the two lines. One is subsoil hydro gradient for pond level condition, another one is subsoil hydro gradient for high flood condition. These are the two hydrologisms. One is for here, if you see pond level 254, downstream side high flood level for this, two upstream side high flood level for pond level condition, high flood level condition, you draw the two hydraulic gem curves.